Hi, everybody. I've had an absolute blast recording your championship intros on audio and also on video. And for those of you that didn't know, the videos can be done special exactly the way you like them, because these are green screens and we can do them with a scene behind me. Do you want a fighting scene? Do you want a beach scene? Do you want a race car scene? Any scene you want, we can give it to you. It's your theme and my pleasure. Just write our offices and we will answer you with the exact fee involved and how it'll get done. So here we are, and now it's time, and it's your choice. Cheers!
From the shores of Malibu where the waves are pumping, to the Great Wall of China, back to the streets of Las Vegas where the UFC is coming, we are live as It's Time Radio, the show where we talk about what you think about but may be afraid to voice. Do not worry, we talk about it all. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, you name it, we talk about it. And I'm here with my co-host, TJ DeSantis. TJ, another week gone by, a lot of action gone by. How are you, my friend?
I'm good. I mean, you could say we get raw, dog.
We get raw, dog. You know why we get raw, dog? Because we got the raw, dog. We got Brandon, raw dog, Royval. Brandon, thanks for coming on the show. I always love having UFC contenders and every other UFC fighter on, but you know, it's great to have you on because you're getting really ready for a big, exciting night in Mexico City. You're going to face former champion Brandon Moreno. This is a fight, actually, that's almost on a championship, is on a championship level itself, with all respect to you, my friend, and respect to Brandon, who's a great guy. Are you excited about this, or that's such a stupid question?
Yeah. I mean, I always feel a little bit every way about it. It's like sometimes I'm excited, and sometimes I'm like, what have I got myself into? But I feel like... on top of like one of the many goals that I've had in the UFC, one of them is to fight someone in their backyard and go into enemy territory. I feel like I've been fortunate enough, and I love the feeling of like, I like being liked, you know what I'm saying? Like, as dumb as that sounds, and like as bad of a career choice I have to want to be liked. But for the most part, I've been a fan favorite. Every time I've entered like a crowd, they cheer for me louder than the other guy. This is gonna be the first time where I'll probably get booed and get like less love than the other guy. So I'm kind of interested in doing all that, you know. And on top of that, it's just a great opportunity. I've never been to Mexico City, a bunch of cool little stuff. So,
well, if you've never been to Mexico City, you're in for a great surprise. I mean, there's great restaurants, food, everybody's really nice. The only issue in Mexico City, you know, is basically the altitude, right? And the altitude is very high. How, a lot of fighters that have gone in.
500 feet, right, Buff?
It's really, really high. I even noticed that when I first went there, and no offense to Mexico City, but the air pollution's horrible.
That's what I'm more worried about, yeah.
It's really bad. And I noticed that when I was announcing there the first time, I actually felt it a little bit when I was announcing, much less you being in there with your cardio and putting your life on the line for three or five-minute rounds. It's, you know, it's definitely something you got to prepare for. So how early are you going into Mexico City?
I might go out there a week earlier than normal, but that being said, is I live in Denver and I do a lot of my training this week. And I'm already like 57,000 feet in the air. And then, I've been going out to the mountains every weekend and just training out there, doing some cardio there, and then grappling, kickboxing, all that stuff. So 2 days a week, I'm up in the mountains working and, getting the cardio in there. So I'm no stranger to altitude, I guess what I'm saying.
Yeah, you're no stranger to altitude. I think that actually gives you a huge advantage. So, yeah. You know, for what you need to do, you know, you formerly competed for Legacy Fighting Alliance, your former Legacy Fighting Alliance flyweight champion. You're number three in the rankings with the UFC in the flyweight rankings. You know what it's like to be a champion. You know what it's like to fight for a championship. Now you're fighting a champion. Brandon Moreno is a pure quality mixed martial artists and so many rights, highly liked. I don't know if you're going to get booed, cheered, whatever, but either way, it should just fuel your fire. Yeah, you'll probably get booed.
Yeah. Most likely getting booed. But what was your question? I'm sorry, I missed the end part.
What was that?
What was the question? I missed the end part.
The end part, I think I didn't even ask a question. Did I, TJ?
Let me ask a question because I think
you asked the question.
When you look at the last fight with Pantoja, obviously, you know, for a championship, the fact that you're fighting Brandon Moreno, Brandon, it feels like this could have been the next fight, even if you beat Pantoja. Like, this isn't a step down. This isn't a step back, despite coming up short in your last fight. Do you feel that?
Yeah, yeah, I absolutely feel like that. I feel like in some rights, it's even more important to fight Brandon Moreno because he's the most popular guy in our division. I mean, obviously winning a bout would be ideal. But I had some, like, maybe not insight, but an idea that Amir Albazi was going to pull out long before Ivan fought for the title. And in my head, I was like, okay, if I win this belt, I want a quick turnaround and defend that belt. And I want to fight Moreno no matter what. But I was like, if Amir Albazi pulls out, I want to jump in that spot and take it and make Moreno fight for a belt against me. So the fact that I lost is like, and then they offered me the opportunity, it was like a no-brainer for me. I was like, hell yeah, we're taking that opportunity. It puts me right into a good position if I win. And on top of that, it's just like, it's I'm a main event of a card. I'm fighting in a different country. I'm fighting enemy territory. On top of all the other million things, it's just the coolest opportunity to me.
You know, at the top of this flyweight division, it's the same, you know, players over and over again. And you're all incredibly entertaining, so I'm not going to get, you know, mad at it by any means. But, you know, you had a better showing against Pantoja the last go around. Obviously, you fought Brandon Moreno in the past and came up short there. I'm curious, do you feel like you're going to have a better showing just based on that experience that you've, you know, shared the octagon with Brandon in the past?
Yeah, yeah. Honestly, I still don't think that fight should count as a loss. Like, I'm actually really annoyed by that. When I look it over and I think about it, I'm like, how's that not a doctor stoppage or anything weird? Because it's like the fact that my shoulder got hurt had zero to do with Brandon Moreno. Like, it, right. The fact that I got injured had nothing to do with him. I was literally on top of the guy, like, doing hammer fists when I got injured. Yeah. So it was just one of those in my head that it's like, I wanted a chance to run it back no matter what the scenario is. The fact that we get to do it in a main event and in Mexico City and all that other cool stuff is just a good opportunity. So I know for a fact it's going to be a way better showing for me. And it's just one of those things that it's like, I wanted the opportunity to go fight him anyways, because it's like that wasn't a fair scenario in my opinion. It wasn't one of those that it's like, I don't think it's the fact that they count it as a loss or they have just like a TKO is like actually a joke to me. So
do you know Brandon personally?
Oh, go ahead.
I ran into him a handful of times. It's not like I would ever like sit down and like ask him questions about his life or anything, but I always talk to him very respectfully, you know, like it's always been nothing but respect.
Cool. You know, one thing that in one of my recent UFCs, I was announcing Charles Jourdain and Sean Woodson, and it was so loud inside the octagon. I made the announcement perfectly correct, even though.
Oh yeah, 100%. I was like, how'd you guys even mistake that?
I know. Even the referee told me he couldn't hear me and inside, you know, that's all been brought out. Dana White explained everything, but just remember you're both named Brandon. Okay. So when I make this announcement in Mexico City, listen closely. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure. Well, hopefully we were going to know who it is before I even go into that, the announcement. I hope I get a finish.
You won't. Well, I mean, if it's very obvious, but you know, nobody knows until I say it. So,
well, if it's a stoppage, we know, Buffer.
Of course.
You know, maybe with this fight, you got to start with the nickname first. Maybe it's the Assassin Baby, Brandon Moreno, or Raw Dog, Brandon Royval.
Well, yeah. While we're on the subject of nicknames, okay, the nicknames are all approved by the UFC. Let me say that again for everybody listening. You know, because there's recent comments made, you know, Jim Miller, God, I love Jim Miller, respect Jim Miller. He's such a great guy. He's an amazing warrior, the whole bit. And he's requesting that I say Jim, you know, Epi Miller.
Yeah.
Miller in the octagon, which I have no problem with effing, but I want to just make the statement for everybody listening. I do not approve the nicknames. Okay. The UFC approves the nicknames, right? So I haven't heard anything about his request from the UFC.
So what you're saying right now is the UFC strongly endorses Raw Dog.
Yeah. Yeah. They actually chose.
They approved Raw Dog. Absolutely. Completely approved it. No,
not only do they approve Raw Dog, I think they actually made the nickname for me. I didn't have a nickname until I got signed to the UFC.
How crazy is that? Seriously, like I'm curious, Brandon. Like when you tell your family, like, oh yeah, I'm Brandon Raw Dog Royval. Like what do family members say? Like what?
I mean, I think that like most of the time, like most of my family was there when we were making the jokes about like the nickname and stuff and how it came along.
Yeah.
But what's really weird is when I'm walking around like with somebody or like walking around with a family or like a girl or something and someone's like, hey, Raw Dog. And I'm like, and then I was like, at this point, like I used to ignore it because I just didn't like ever think of it as my name or anything.
Right.
Or I would just look back like someone beyond Raw Dog, you know, like what the fuck? But then now it's just like I respond to it. And that's even weirder to me. Like if someone's like, hey, Raw Dog. I'm like, hey, what's up? And I'm like, the hell? Like, I gotta get rid of it. Yeah. But
let me ask
they're
you a
there
question.
For the most part.
Does Raw Dog have an actual meeting? Because what's wrong with Raw Dog?
It's like, no,
Buffalo. Oh, no,
you
no.
Have this conversation on the air?
Yeah, it's just a tough.
I'm not aware of that. I have to look it up.
So
don't look it up. Don't look it up.
We gotta tell him, Brittany.
Actually, I'm gonna look it up right now. Look it up right now.
No, look up images. No, I'm just kidding.
No. So Bruce, if you get down to business with the lady,
okay, I got it. I'm not gonna say anything.
Okay. So you use protection. You're raw dogging it.
Got it. I got it.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, there you go. You proved it.
Yeah, I know, right? I can't even believe it. That was like it was one of those things too. Is like when I got signed to LFA, I was trying not to use it. Like I didn't want it as a nickname. I was actually surprised that they would even announce it on TV. So then maybe like the first two fights, I was just like laughing that they put it on TV.
Yeah.
And then I tried to get rid of it, and then the LFA announcer Mike Kindle just stuck with it. Like he kept saying it no matter what. I mean, no matter how many times I was like, bro, get rid of this nickname, he would lean into it. And then when I got signed to the UFC, I didn't even think I don't even list it down because I was like, you know, I'm in the UFC. I don't want to do that. And I never listed it down and they still just have done it. So at this point, it's just like, it's one of those nicknames that just kind of stuck, you know, and it was originally a joke and then it just went too far.
That's interesting. If you guys remember, I mean, Bruce, I'll ask you remember Chad Mendez's nickname?
Shoot. God, so long as I pronounced Chad. Chad.
Chad Mini Mendez.
Yeah.
Chad what?
Money. It was Money.
Yeah, Money Mendez. Money Mendez.
Right, but it was shortened because when he was coming up through regionals, he was Chad Money Shot Mendez. But when he got to the UFC, they dropped the shot part and he was just Chad Money Mendez. So there is definitely influence there, but I don't know. I guess, Brandon, if Buffer doesn't know what Raw Dog means, maybe whoever at the UFC, you know, that was proven nicknames that day didn't know either.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, at this point, it's like, I can't get rid of it, so it doesn't even matter.
That's the best nickname, right? Like, you shouldn't pick your nickname. You know, nickname.
Yeah, 100%.
Earned. I mean, I don't know if you've necessarily earned this. I don't want to say that, but.
It's been earned. No, it's fine.
it's all good. You know, and even get down, let me tell you, when I say that, you know, I get bios, right? And the bios list the nicknames. And they also listed exactly how you want it said. Do you want it said before your name? Do you want it said in the middle of your name? So it says in the middle of the name, like Brandon Raw Dog Royval, I'm not going to announce you as the winner as Raw Dog Brandon Royval because the bio is the way you want it announced, right?
Yeah.
So I always respect the fighter, no matter what people want to comment on now. I always respect the fighter and how they want themselves announced based on the approval that I get on the bio from the UFC. It's not up to me to give you a nickname.
Yeah. I always wanted one of those like long nicknames like boxers with like, you know, like six different aliases and then like, you know what I'm saying? I always thought about that one.
There are some long ones.
The longest I think in UFC history has got to be Antonio Minotauro, Rodrigo Nogueira. No?
There's one coming up that I was just doing on the show that's happening. Let me tell you real quick while we're talking about it. And I noticed.
I feel like those are the longest ones. Like when you.
Those are long.
When
those
you
got to
take like a breath in the middle, you know, that's. A
oh, I can get that out. There's another one here. No, that's probably the longest one, which was a lot of fun to announce. In the upcoming show on Saturday at the Apex, there's the Pride.
Charles Johnson.
Yep. The Pride of St. Louis, Charles Energy Johnson. So he's got two nicknames.
Yeah, I love that. That's what I would be like, the Pride of Denver, Colorado, the Mile High Strangler, the King of Danger, Brandon, Raw Dog. I won't even go longer, but you know.
Well, you know what? You got plenty of time. Put it in. Get the approval. I get the bio from the UFC, and it tells me what to say.
I mean, that's almost like a dangerous move up there at that altitude, Buffer. I mean.
I know.
But I got the lungs. Don't worry about it. I got the lungs.
Say it again, Brandon. What do you want?
I want the Mile High Strangler, the King of Denver, the King of Queens. I don't even know. I want something long though. You know how boxers like they have like the WBA champ, and then they'll have like six different nicknames, and then announce their actual real nickname in that.
I kind of like the idea of it rhyming a little bit.
Oh yeah, for sure. I'll definitely make it better if I get the option.
The mile,
I'll make it better.
Let me see one thing here.
Danger.
Wait, hold on. The Mile High Strangler, the King of Denver, Brandon Raw Dog Royval.
that's easy. I think I want something longer.
Yeah. The Mile High Strangler, A Man Who Fears No Danger, something like that.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah, actually, something like that.
Wasn't the Mile High Strangler Ted Bundy's nickname? Oh, sorry, just making a joke. Horrible.
the 5 foot assassin. I want a bunch of stuff, man. There's a bunch of cool nicknames that I could just go off on.
The Mile High Assassin, the man who'll kick your ass in.
Yeah. I haven't really thought about it too much. The Mile High Strangler always sounded dope to me, though.
Well, you decide what's best for you. You decide what's best for you getting in there because you're the one putting your blood, sweat, and tears on the octagon floor. So,
yeah. Put it down. That's like another thing, too, is I feel like being in the UFC is so surreal to me still. And, like, I cannot make eye contact with you. When you announce my nickname, I'm like, just stay locked in. Just pick a point on the mat. Look around. I feel like most fighters
are.
Why
you look down? Because I'm always looking into the eye of the tiger, Brandon. I'm always staring you right in the eyes.
Oh, I know. I feel like I'm the only fighter that's too intimidated to look at you in the eye. I'm like, I'm going to look over here. I'm going to look over here. Yeah. The first time you announced me, I was like, I started looking at you. And then I'm like, all right, I'm overthinking this. Like, and then I had to start pacing around and like, so I've always kind of been that, like, I don't know. It's just like, this is all a dream come true, you know? So it's like, when I look around, like my last fight, I looked around and there's all the fighters and I look up and then there's the, what is his name? Jared Leto, the guy who played the Joker.
Yeah.
I straight up made eye contact with Jared Leto that I looked away. And then I looked straight at Donald Trump and this dude goes, and I was like, oh shit. And I was like, nodded to him. And I look over the other side and I was like, I'm just gonna keep my head down because this is intimidating and it's just easy to stay locked in the, like, where I'm at right now, you know? And I feel like that's always the best case for me because it's like, if I start looking around and then seeing people in the audience, I'll start overthinking stuff. And that's like, at the end of the day, I'm just fighting somebody. Like, I don't want to overthink anything. It's just a fight. I've been doing this. I've been in way too many fights in my life. And it's like overthinking everything else is what gets me in trouble sometimes. So
overthinking gets a lot of people in trouble. I've been a victim of that myself more than a few times. So.
Yeah, I get that.
Just making a standard decision in life, overthinking can be an issue.
Yeah. So that's why sometimes it's like I like look down when you're announcing me because I'm like,
I don't take it personal.
Of your 8 UFC fights, Brandon, how many has Buffer done?
Probably like at least 5 of them.
Wow,
really? Yeah. I've missed that many, 2 or 3.
Yeah, because some of them were at the Apex, and like some of them were during COVID times and stuff too. So.
And do you look down at the floor when Joe Martinez is announcing?
Probably, yeah. Joe Martinez used to announce me for a combat day too, so yeah, maybe a little less, but I don't think he makes eye contact the way you do.
Well, no, he's an excellent announcer. You know, he does his thing straightforward, you know, standard boxing type announcing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All good. Yeah, you're looking at us and I'm like, oh God.
Yeah, Buffer stares into the souls of the people that he announces.
I try to give him
my all. You know, you walk in there and you're at a high point in your life. You've been training 8 to 10 weeks for this moment. It's the moment that you've been waiting for. My job is to take you, if I can, to that next level. And that's what I try to do every time. The moment I can't do that, I'm going to retire. I'm done.
I get that, man. That's so awesome.
I can't wait for this. I want to hear his new folds in this nickname, though. The Mile High Strangler.
I know. I'm
going to say it one last time on the show. I don't approve nicknames. You tell the UFC what you would like. They approve the nicknames.
Well, I guess we're going to find out if Brandon goes for it or not. I can't wait. Yeah. Another reason to tune into this upcoming fight.
Yeah, straight up. That's hilarious.
Very cool. Hey, you're in Denver. You're having, like, we have a big rainstorm here. It's pretty much one of the...
It's bad right now.
It's bad right now.
Are you guys in Vegas?
The worst one is on the way. This is not the worst one, but I hear Denver's having... You're having, like, horrific weather right now.
Yeah, we're in SoCal, Brandon. So, like, we have a thing where it's like... They called it an atmospheric reservoir. Is it basically like they're supposed to be like in the sky with the clouds? There's a river that's literally dumping itself on Los Angeles right now. It's not good.
Dang. Yeah. No, in Denver, this is like the nicest weather we've had in weeks. Like the sun would be out like maybe 2 weeks ago. The sun would be out. But like I couldn't walk my dog out in the cold. Like I'd had to have like a bandana on my face. It was bad. Like it was so cold.
Yeah, you had to wrap your dog up for the walk, is what you're saying?
Yeah. He has his little boots on. He gets all annoyed when I put them on him. But for the most part, it's just like it was so cold. But like this week, these last 2 days, 3 days, I like walking around with just no hoodie on, like just stuff like that, where it's like I haven't been used to that in a while, man.
That's very cool. I heard it was horrific weather. I was worried about that, but
it's gonna happen in a few days. I heard there's like a bad snowstorm coming.
probably the one that we have. Brandon, when we have yours coming over your way.
Brandon Royval wraps his dog up when he goes for a walk.
Yeah, my dog's the most spoiled person in my life.
My dog all the other times.
Wrap the dog. Yeah, raw dog, doesn't it? I guess now that I understand the full meaning behind all that.
Yeah, it's the only dog getting wrapped, I guess. I'm just kidding.
Hey, you broke your wrist in 2022. Any issues with that?
Not necessarily. I actually just got approved, which is funny because I took the fight like maybe 2 weeks ago. I just got a letter that said I got approved to fight in Mexico City because I broke my hand in against the Pantoja fight. So
so not only you broke your wrist once, then you broke your hand?
Yeah. I think it was the other. So I think I broke it was both the same side. But yeah, I broke my hand in that fight.
Ouch. Is this the first time you broke your hand?
No. No, it's the second time I broke my hand. I fought with a broken hand before one time too. I've done a lot of dumb decisions in this MMA career, but one of them I fought with a broken hand, and then I had somebody like my cornerman. I was like, "You got to wrap it up tight because my hand's broke." Like going to fight, my hand was broke, and right before I walked out, I was like, "Bro, I don't have any circulation in my hand. Like, you got to cut this off." So like we had to make a last minute adjustment right before I walked out, and it was a little bit of a disaster.
That's tough. I only know from personal experience when I was kickboxing a lot, you know, a carpal tunnel syndrome issue with my hand. You got to let it heal 100%. Otherwise, it's going to wreak havoc on you through your career, you know?
Yeah, constantly, for sure. That's actually like a lesson that I keep learning over and over again is just take care of my injuries because when you don't, it just turns into something big, you know?
Yeah, you want to be careful about that, but you got to make your money. We all understand that, but you still want to take care of yourself. You're a machine. You know, you got to make that machine, just keep it healthy, keep it working.
Yeah, straight up, man.
Family-wise, are you married?
No, I'm not married. No, cool. I don't even know. I got to have much of a family. It's just me and my dog in my house right now, honestly.
Well, good. Less money, less people to spend more money on.
I know. I was talking to like my financial advisor. He's like, "You're literally Uncle Sam's favorite nephew right now." And I was like, "Yeah, that's true." He's like, he's just taxing me to the fullest right now.
Very cool. Hey, you know, I don't ask fighters a lot of this, but do you have a favorite fighter other than yourself in the UFC? Do you have somebody that you're a big fan of?
Sorry, dude, this cut me off so many.
No, we're good.
My favorite fighter, not in the UFC right now, but Nick Diaz is like, oh my God, my favorite fighter ever. I go back, watch his highlights, all that stuff. So Nick Diaz is probably like my all-time favorite fighter. But in the UFC, I like watching Corey Sandhagen fight, man. I'm a huge Corey Sandhagen fan. I like Sean O'Malley fighting. Those two specifically are probably my favorite to watch.
Yeah, Sean O'Malley. I mean, he's got it. He's got the it factor. He's here, but he's up and coming. There's so much more ahead of Sean O'Malley in his career. It's funny. I was just watching George St. Pierre. You said George St. Pierre? Who did you say?
I said Corey Sandhagen.
Oh, Nick Diaz. Nick Diaz. Yeah. I was just watching highlights of his fights with George St. Pierre just the other day. I'm a big fan of the Diaz brothers. You know, as I'm a big fan of every fighter that steps in the octagon, but. Something about Nick Diaz early in his career. I mean, he definitely walked to his own tune as his brother Nate does. Pretty unreal.
Yeah. And like I said, I feel like he's just so to himself, man. And that's always cool to see too. Just like real raw authenticity, you know? And I feel like even some of these guys that like maybe get played as being themselves, I feel like some of them are playing characters too. It's like they're overly doing it and like all that other stuff.
Let me ask you, give me two fighters that overdo their characters. If you
Sean and Colby.
Who?
Sean Strickland and Colby. Like I feel like they're like two guys that are like, you know, yeah, I think they're a little bit of that, and then they're just trying to take it even further and further, and it's just like I don't even know if that's really
I respect that.
Sorry, not to get super sidetracked here, but with Strickland, I feel like he's trying to deliver what people want from him, but I don't know if it's much of a hammed up version. Where with Colby, it's 100%, you know, lab created, if you will. Like,
yeah,
Colby has his lines, many of his lines rehearsed before he even gets to where he's going. Sean is completely off the cuff.
Right. I feel like Sean is definitely like jumping over the, you know, invisible line, but I don't think it's necessarily like him going, "Hey, I'm going to go do this." It's him going, "People expect me to sort of say some outlandish things. I'm going to say the things that I feel are, you know, honest and true to him, but they definitely come off outlandish."
Well, we know one thing. Yeah. If Sean was an announcer, he'd have no problem saying Jim Miller's nickname.
yeah, for sure.
He'd probably add a few in there as well.
Yeah.
Probably add a few, yeah.
Hey, we got to let Brandon go. Brandon, thank you for coming on, man. Best of luck against
I appreciate your guys' time, man. Thank you guys very much. Thank you guys for fitting me in. Have a good
day. Brandon, you take care. Train hard, train safe. I'll see you in Mexico City. And do yourself a favor when you land, drink bottled water only. Okay.
Okay. All right, for sure. I appreciate you, man. Sure. Thank you very much. Right. Have a good day.
See you. There he is. The raw dog.
Yeah.
By the way, that's a good tip, Buff. Bottled water in Mexico City.
When you're showering, don't swallow any water.
I made the mistake, first time I went to Mexico City, made the mistake of using non-bottled water when I brushed my teeth. And it wasn't as bad as it could have been, but I got real sick.
Just takes one of those little parasites to get in your body.
Yeah. I don't know if it was necessarily that or what happened, but I was doing an Eddie Bravo Invitational down there. And let's just say the last match, I definitely needed to go to the bathroom, and it just took forever.
But probably every commentator and announcer's biggest fear, commentators especially, because you're glued to your seat, is the bathroom run. I can't tell you how many times you'll see Anik and Rogan like running, and me too, because we got 2 minutes.
Yeah, I don't eat generally on event day when I'm calling fights, just because you don't know when it's gonna, you know, have to be business, and you don't have that time to conduct that sort of business. So mainly just water. Water and light fare for me on event day. And I don't get the pacing that you guys get when I do a Fight Pass show, Buff. We're on the air and we go. We don't have commercial breaks. So if the show's five and a half hours, it's 5.5 hours. I'm not going anywhere.
Yeah. Yeah, no. No, I mean, it's 8 hours. Listen, I've said it before and I'll say it again.
I don't think I could do an 8-hour show. I don't know how you guys do it, but yeah, like we don't get the breaks that you do.
Yeah, even though I'm interacting with production and directors and everybody or the fans, you know, as much as I can in between fights, the bottom line is, as a commentator, you're on the mic the whole time.
Yeah.
So nonstop. I have so much respect for you and Anik and DC and Rogan and all the guys. People don't understand the amount that goes into that work, especially a guy like John Anik. And I'm sure yourself, the preparatory work you have to do the night before or 2 nights before the show, it's watching videos and doing this. I mean, people really have no idea what goes into your job. So.
But, I mean, that's how you know you're doing a good job. People don't know.
Make it look simple. Make it look easy.
Exactly. You just show up. I don't know who's fighting. Who's that guy? I'm just going to say some random facts I know off the top of my head.
Yep. Exactly. Well, all good.
Yeah.
Let's put it this way. It's a lot more than just reading off a card, as they say.
I mean, you got to write the card. You got to find the information to put on the card.
There you go.
And then you got to make sure that what's on the card is applicable to what's happening in front of you.
Well, it's all about the performance at the end.
Yeah.
Both for you and for me. But anyway,
what's funny is people don't really realize that it is truly that, a performance, right? Like they don't understand, but that's all right. It's good.
That's why. Yeah. I'm not blowing my horn, but you know, I mean, yeah, I'm an announcer, but I mean, listen, it's show business. It's not show business. It's show business. You want to create entertainment for the crowd,
100%.
But I'll say it again. I've said it a million times. The show is not about me. It's not about you. It's about those fighters inside the octagon, and 100%. We're there to serve them. We are there to serve them, and that's it.
Absolutely.
All right, let's go into some news.
Got any good news? It's a new year.
Not a lot of good news here.
No.
I'm trying.
2024 hasn't just changed the tone of the world, and we're not all duckies and bunnies and happy.
What? Drone attacks, you know, reportedly by Iran, killing 3 and wounding 30. That's not good news.
God knows what's
going to come out of that, and the way that President Biden is going to strike back if he is, and when he does.
Drone attacks where? Like, what did they attack?
Oh, you didn't hear about this?
I'm just trying to get the story out of you, Buff.
It was an attack on Sunday. It was on a small outpost. It was the first time American troops have been killed by enemy fire in the Middle East.
Okay, so it was
beginning of the Gaza outpost. War. Pardon me?
It was an American outpost.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, a lot of people feared this was going to happen since the first attack on October 7th.
And this was from Iran, like their military?
Well, they're supposedly, if I heard correctly, they're denying the fact. But it was a drone attack.
Okay.
I'm hearing Iran. The bottom line, it could create a broader conflict in the Middle East.
Yeah.
And none of us want to see that. You know,
I mean, it's pretty bad right now already. So
also 40 other servicemen were injured in this attack too.
Wow. Right? You know, that's the thing that's sort of crazy about this. And I've seen this with the Russian and Ukraine war is you can fashion these relatively consumer level drones into war machines. And it's hard to point now, Bruce. I mean, we've seen this since, you know, the war on terror began, where your, you know, troops for a long time, you know, U.S. troops have been battling these terror groups, you know, and these terror groups don't necessarily wear uniforms. It's not, you know, organized warfare as, you know, the world has been accustomed to for thousands of years. And now, you know, you have this sort of advanced technology, you know, killing service people. And it's like you can't even point to whether or not it's an organized military or a radical, you know, person by themselves or who's necessarily behind it.
Tough business we're in, you know, tough world we're in. There's just so much going on. Mm-hmm. You know, we all want peace, and then many obviously don't. And they never will. So we'll see what happens. We don't want to go to war with Iran. You know what that means, if God forbid that happens? Potential of Russia and China backing him. That's the last thing we want to happen. And speaking of China, the FBI director just issued a dramatic public warning. FBI Director Christopher Wray says the Chinese hackers are now preparing to wreak havoc and cause real world harm on the U.S. I don't even know what that means.
Yeah.
You know, attacking the infrastructure, whatever, banking.
I assume those cyber attacks are, you know, always going. You mentioned Iran. I can't remember what the documentary is, but there's a phenomenal documentary about this malware that the U.S. Implemented in one of their, you know, nuclear facilities to like try to slow down their harvesting of plutonium or uranium or something like that.
Right.
That's a different level of warfare altogether. And not that, you know, this warning doesn't surprise me or alarm me, Bruce, but I just assume that cyber attacks are being thwarted and probably some are being successful every single day of our lives.
They are probably, I can agree with you on that. And we're not going to hear about it.
Obviously. Of course not. No,
you know, it's like saying that, you know, a UFO landed in Colorado. We're not going to hear about it. Not from the government anyway. Who knows? Maybe we will, maybe we won't.
Mm.
But you know how I believe in UFOs. It's a whole nother subject. Right.
Sure.
If we're here, they're there.
It's just whether or not it's an alien. There are many things in the sky that we don't know what they are. They're unidentified.
Oh, okay. But I mean, I believe in there's living forms out there.
I don't know, Bruce. I think if anything is smart enough to travel light years to get here, they're smart enough to not come down here because we're not the greatest people to get along with.
Okay, we'll leave it at that. I don't can really comment beyond that. But anyway, it's a interesting, fun, and scary thought all at the same time.
I definitely think that there are other life forms out there. I just don't know if they're coming on spaceships here.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I have to believe there's other life forms, you know.
Yeah, but you're saying they land here. I don't know if they land here or not.
I didn't say that. I just wouldn't be surprised, nor would I deny the fact that the possibility.
I think you're crazy if you're denying it. So.
Yeah, exactly. All right. Maybe we're the ones that are crazy or saying it's true. Who knows? Who knows who's crazy?
I don't think so.
With everything going on. All right. Listen, a couple other things. Oakland Denny's. Denny's in Oakland, another sign of what's going on. We talked about In-N-Out closing last week.
Right, yeah.
Denny's now shut down due to the crime following the In-N-Out closure.
Yeah. Oakland. Hopefully Oakland can get better.
Oakland, San Francisco, those whole areas up there.
Yeah.
And, you know, we adopted a lot of the same laws here in Los Angeles. You know that.
Yeah. To me, though, Bruce, like a lot of it just comes down to the fact like the cost of living is absolutely insane out there. And I think desperate times cause people to do desperate things. And I don't know. I'm not trying to fix things. I don't know the whole story, but when you look at what it costs to live up there and why there are so many, you know, homeless people there, and a lot of it has to do with like mental health. I believe that's a you know, big contributing factor to homelessness in this country. But, you know, you hope for the best.
Hope for the best, you know, hope for the best. So all I can say, everybody stay safe.
To figure it out, unfortunately.
Yeah. Right, thank you to Medical Everything. I'm sorry. Thank you to MedicalEverything.com, our sponsor for the show. Thank you to Puncher's Chance, our sponsors for the show. And It's Time Cologne, our sponsors for the show. So all good. There's my shilling effect. Let's go on to some other stuff here. In sports, Jackie Robinson statue. You read about that?
Mm-mm.
Jackie Robinson, one of the greatest baseball players ever. All that he represented and helped in and out and beyond baseball. Respect to everybody, you know, and getting along. Enough said there. The statue was stolen right? Wow. And they found it burned and destroyed days later after being stolen.
The statue you're referring to, does this sit outside of Dodger Stadium?
It stood outside a youth baseball park.
Okay.
Okay. And in Wichita, Kansas. It's horrible. The firefighters in Wichita, Kansas found it and received a call, and literally somebody just ruined this whole beautiful bronze statue.
Yeah.
Right? And why do that?
Here's the thing. This could be a couple of things. Obviously, there could be, you know, racial undertones, and, you know, it was done to create some sort of statement, which is absolutely ridiculous. I hope that's not the case. The other thing, it could very well be just mischievous kids looking to do something that they shouldn't be doing. And to me, it's insane that you can actually, like, steal a bronze statue. I assume that this is pretty heavy. It was probably secured in a way that it wasn't easy to, you know, cut up and get out of there. But
you sliced it at the ankles.
Yeah, like, I just, but if it's bronze, like, do you have a blowtorch? Like, what do you do? How you?
I don't know. It also takes time to do it, you know.
Right. Yeah.
Jackie Robinson is so amazing and historical as a baseball player. I mean, his collectibles alone, a game used, you know, BK Dodgers glove hit the auction block. They're expected to go for $750,000.
Yeah.
A handwritten letter by him talking about the Holocaust, you know, a long time ago. Is for sale for $150,000. You know, it's just,
yeah,
that's in the collectible end. But the bottom line is, it's just, there's just no need. There's no,
no
need.
But again, I mean, there's no excuse for this. I just hope that it's a case of kids being stupid kids and not someone trying to send sort of, you know, a message, you know,
unless somebody comes forward, nobody's going to know. So we'll see. I just wanted to bring it up because, again, this is just horrific. It's just wrong. It's just wrong.
No, it's
horrible. What is horrific is what's going on in the Middle East and such as that. That's horrific. It's just wrong. It's wrong. All right, let's talk about
any good stories here, Buff.
Yeah. We'll talk a little football.
Okay. I thought we had good stories.
Well, they are good stories.
It depends on who you cheer for, I guess.
All right. Oh, before we go into that, you know that Alec Baldwin, you know, he was indicted in that shooting on that movie, the Rust movie.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, he pleaded not guilty for the second time.
Okay.
It's crazy, huh?
Yeah, I mean...
Remember that situation?
Yeah, it was supposed to be like a blank, and unfortunately...
Yeah.
Projectile got put in there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Terribly sad.
It's terrible. Anyway, okay, we'll get off it. Let's get off all that. Positive.
Positive story, Buff.
Okay, you watched football last week in the games, and, you know, I told you I went 100% in my picks the week before. Last week, there were only two games, and I went 50-50.
Which one did you get right? You got the Niners right?
Yeah, I took Detroit plus 7.5. Very well could have won that game. Why they did not kick the field goal to tie the game at a key point is beyond me, but I respect the coach and his decision to go for the win. It would have been a whole different turnout. Let me give you an interesting thing. Lamar Jackson and the Ravens won. Lamar Jackson and the Ravens lost.
Yeah.
To Kansas City, Mahomes and Kansas City going on being the reigning defending Super Bowl champions, which is probably how I would refer to them if I ever announce them. And again, if you're watching TV anywhere in sports, watch Super Bowl opening night, Monday, February 5th, and I think you'll be in for a little surprise. And we'll just leave it at that.
Okay.
Okay. Interesting fact. San Francisco quarterback Purdy made $870,000 in 2020.
Yeah.
Lamar Jackson.
Yeah.
Made $80 million.
Al Michaels, one of my favorite broadcasters, does Thursday Night Football for Amazon Prime. You know how much he makes a game?
I would suspect a lot.
$1 million.
Yeah.
He makes more doing one game than Brock Purdy does in a season.
Yeah. It's amazing.
Think about that. Yeah. Don't worry. Brock's going to get paid.
He's going to renegotiate his contract. He'll get paid quite well.
Yeah.
And if he wins,
oh, dude,
the world's his oyster. Name it.
Yeah.
Name it.
Yeah.
Nobody can argue with that renegotiation, I'm sure.
100%.
So the Niners are facing the Chiefs. The Chiefs are plus +2. My pick would be, again, it's either one can win game. But I'm going to sit and wait. Hopefully the line goes to 3 or 2.5. I'm going to buy it
2 weeks still, or a week and a half. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I'm going to buy it to 3.5. Take the, I'm going to, no matter what it is, I'll buy it up. Chiefs plus 3.5.
It's a rematch. You know, these two teams were in the Super Bowl a few years ago, and I'll make the same pick today that I made then.
Which was?
Joe Montana's former team will win.
Great team. Great team.
Which one?
He was on both. Gotcha.
Made the same mistake last time, too.
Great teams. I made the same mistake last time.
He's a 49er forever. Yes. And of course, he was a 49er, but he was a Chief as well. And Joe Montana's former team will win.
One of the greatest quarterbacks of all time. There's no question. There's no question. You know, we talked about collectibles. By the way, the cool thing about this 2 week layoff is that everybody can get healthy.
Yeah.
2 weeks. I mean, there's definitely injuries going on.
That's always the way it goes. Because now they sandwich in the Pro Bowl in that off week, if you will. So,
is the Pro Bowl this weekend?
Yeah, in Orlando.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's right. That's right. You know, I announced it in Vegas 2 years ago, or two seasons ago. That was a lot of fun. That was definitely a lot of fun. Was it 2 seasons ago? Two seasons ago. I did it. TJ, what's going up with you? I mean, we got UFC coming in here on Saturday from the Apex. You know, it's an interesting card here. What do we got? It's, hold on. Yeah, Delize and Imabov in the main event. That's going to be a tough go. Moicano, Drew Dober.
That's going to be a great fight.
That's going to be a great fight.
Yeah, that's almost the main event in a lot of ways, at least from the entertainment aspect. That's a fight that I would want to see. If you only get to see one fight, obviously I don't, but you know, gun to my head, only pick one fight. That's the fight I'm picking.
Now, if I'm not mistaken, there's another one right after this show. It's the other show that Dana has. There's going to be a second fight that night or event that night. Am I wrong?
Power Slap?
Not Power Slap.
Well, it's not a contender series.
I thought I saw something about
probably Power Slap. I don't know.
I'm not sure either. Pardon me for saying that. I'm not sure. Natalia Silva and Viviani Araujo. That should be a really good flyweight fight between the ladies. Salikov, Randy Rudeboy Brown coming in. All good. Mahmoud Moradov. Always like watching Mahmoud fight. Again, he's fighting Ali Azab. Hizriyev, who's undefeated. You know, another Russian undefeated fighter.
Good for you.
Good solid card. Meatball Molly McCann coming in and fighting Diana Bodie. McCann fighting Bobita. That should be really good. Yeah, good solid show.
Yeah.
And of course, you want to know what's going on with me?
You started asking me what was going on with me, and then I never got to answer.
Yeah, I want to know what's going on with you.
Yeah, I'm calling fights coming up Sunday night out in Houston for Fury FC. They're a Fight Pass live event partner. Really good regional scene out there in Texas, and Fury FC has been behind it. They have a show which is not actually on Fight Pass. It's going to be on YouTube. But they kind of borrow from Dana's concept of the Contender Series. This is the Fury FC Challenger Series. So not their traditional flagship show, but still an opportunity for some of the best fighters in the Southwest to showcase their talents. And I'm very excited to go out there and be a part of their broadcast team. I've never worked with the Fury guys for their MMA show. They're, you know, behind the scenes guys. Rich and Eric are very pivotal to our Fight Pass Invitational shows. They're kind of running the infrastructure behind the scenes when it comes to athlete relations. And it's great for them to have me come out to Houston this weekend to work with their MMA event. I haven't called a lot of MMA the last couple of years, Buff. I don't know why. It's been, for whatever reason, boxing and jiu-jitsu more than anything. But, you know, it's fun for me to get back to my roots and call some mixed martial arts.
Hey, listen, it's your original love, and good luck to you, and have a great time doing it. Speaking of boxing, there's a promo release for the new Tyson Fury fight that my brother Michael was in. It's probably the best fight promo I've ever seen. I think I send you a copy of it. Check
I'll
it out.
I'll take a look at it. Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean,
it's really, they just put a lot of money and originality to it. Got a whole gladiator effect. So cool. Kudos to the promoters of that fight. And of course, it'll be in Saudi Arabia, where we will be this year at some point. You know, the UFC is going to go to Saudi at some point. I believe it'll happen.
Yeah, there's a date scheduled. There was one. It got moved. I want to say it's like May, maybe April, May, something like that.
I can't say for sure until it's formally announced, but I heard potentially.
No, it's formally announced, Buff.
It has been for, is yeah, it June? Maybe. Then it would be in June.
I'm pretty sure it's formally announced. Rumor is June 22nd. Maybe it's not formally announced. I'll look it up here if you want me to, but yeah.
Did you say June 22nd?
That's the rumor date. I'm trying to pull it up on the UFC's website now to see.
Yeah, let me know, because I'd like to know myself.
I mean, someone will tell you. That's way more official than
me. Yeah, somebody better tell me.
I mean, that
all
it?
Good.
We're done?
That's it. All right, never rains in California, just pours, and it's doing it right now.
June 22nd, official on UFC website, Riyadh at Kingdom Arena.
Really?
Yep.
Thank you. You know what? Here's an example of the way I work. I'm putting it right in my calendar.
There you go. UFC Fight Night, TBD versus TBD.
That might even be a show that's going to be on ABC. Who knows?
Well, right now it's TBD.
TBD? Okay. TBD, maybe on ABC. All right. TJ?
Mm-hmm.
Sign off, my friend.
Yeah, just check out Fury FC's Challenger Series coming up Sunday night live on YouTube. You can follow me on Twitter at TJ DeSantis or whatever they call it, X. Instagram as well. TJ DeSantis, and that's it, Buff.
All right, everybody. Listen, have a great week. I'll see you from the Apex on Saturday. Next show for me is Anaheim, UFC 2. Wow, it's amazing, huh? UFC 298. It's unbelievable. And then, you know, the big 300 show coming up in Miami in April. Should be exciting. So I will see you all from the Apex on Saturday. I'll possibly see you on Monday if you're tuning in to what's going on in the NFL. We'll leave it at that. And we'll be back next week with another show, the show before the Super Bowl. And we'll definitely be putting in the decisive 5-star winning pick for the Super Bowl, depending on who your favorite team is. And for me personally, I like both teams. I'm just going to make a conscientious decision involving a little
conscientious Joe Montana's team.
Decision. Okay.
Joe
Montana's team. I'm going to go for Joe Montana's team. That's how you say it. All right, everybody. Set your goals. Write them down. Believe in your dreams. Be the best you can be. You want to be a winner, believe in yourself, no matter what you do. So when you set out on that yellow brick road to your future success, personal, business, and otherwise, just perform at your best, and then you're winning. Big cheers, everybody. Thank you for tuning in. We'll be back next week. Buffer out, TJ out. Big cheers, no fears, everybody. Enjoy. Thank you so much.